So we're in part three of this series. And today we're going to be talking about extraordinary love. Extraordinary love. And so the world has a way of doing relationships. We're finding this out. We're contrasting ordinary from extraordinary. The world's way from God's way. So the world has a way of doing love. The world has a way of love, and God has a way of love. And they are in stark contrast to each other. I mean, we even use that word love so loosely, don't we? I love pizza. How many are with me? I love some pizza. I love donuts. Give me some Krispy Kreme. I love donuts. I love ice cream. Some of you would say, I love chocolate. We say all these things, but then we tell our the same word we use for our spouse. Well, I love them too. I love, and so we had, there's all these misconceptions, I believe, of this word. What is love? And the world gets it wrong, so wrong. The world thinks that love is a feeling. It's this the ocean of emotion. It's this knot in my stomach every time I get around that person. No, you ate a bad burrito is what happened. It's not, love is not a feeling. It's not a feeling at all. Some people think that love is also uncontrollable. Like you can't, we talked about this, like oh, I just fell in love. Like it's a ditch or something. Or I fell out of love. Oh, I couldn't help it. I just fell in love, or I fell out of love. No, listen, love is not a feeling. Love is an action. And love is not uncontrollable. Love is a choice. It's so important that we understand this concept of love. Like, what is our understanding of love? This is so vitally important. Here's what the Bible says. This is why it's so important that we get the right understanding of what love is. That we're not doing it the world's way. We're not stuck in ordinary love. This is what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 14 and 1. It says, make love your greatest aim. Make love the goal of your life. Make love the target you're shooting for. Make love the thing that you're running this race for in life. Make love your greatest aim. Well, now what is love to you? Let's make sure we're pointing at the right target. Make love, the Bible says, that needs to be the goal of your life. That you would make love your goal. Make love your ambition. Make love your greatest aim. Which means that the message I'm going to give you today about love is the most important message that you're ever going to hear. Is a topic of love. On this, it is the most important topic in the entire Bible. In fact, the Bible goes as far to say, Jesus goes as far to say, that this is to be the distinguishing mark of a Christian. This is the thing, the mark on a follower of Christ. This is how what separates the ordinary from the extraordinary is this right here, is what we're talking about. Jesus said this in John 13, 35, by this all men will know that you're part of me, that you come from me, that you're my disciple. By this thing right here, you're going to know. By the way you treat people, by the way you love people, it's not through your church attendance, it's not through your Bible knowledge, it's not through your all what you have or what you don't have. A lot of things that we think are so important, it's really based on how we treat other people, how we love others. That determines if we're a follower of Christ or not. So I wanted to take this a little bit deeper and realize that today there's so much confusion about this word love. And partly because in our dictionary, we only have, in our English language, we only have this one word, love. You know, I love, you know, it describes so many things on the inside of us. But fortunately, the Bible was written in the Greek language, a language that is much more descriptive than our English language. We get this one word, love, to talk about pizza and ice cream than we do for the people we really love in life. We get the one word, love. But the Bible is written in Greek. Your New Testament was written in Greek, and it gives us multiple words for this word that we get, love. And so I want to do a little Bible study with you. We're going to dive in a little bit deeper to God's word. I want to show you I have four different words that mean that we just get the one word love, but we have four different meanings to broaden your understanding of this concept of love today. I want you to take some notes. We're going to do a little Bible study today. The first Greek word for love found in your New Testament is the word storge. It literally means natural affection. Natural affection, it's the love that you just have inherently for certain people. It's the bond, it's this love bond between brothers and sisters, parents for their kids. You love them. Isn't it true that you love your parents differently than you love your spouse? It's a different kind of love. You love them, you deeply love them both. It's just a different kind of love than the love of ice cream. I mean, it's different, right? It's different. It's just a different kind of love. And the Bible uses this word storge when it says in Romans chapter 12, verse 10, be devoted to one another in brotherly storge. In other words, he's saying, I want you to learn how to love people with this natural affection, the same type of natural affection you have for your kids, that you have for your parents. I want you to learn how to love people that way with a natural love, a storge love. Honor one another above yourselves, the Bible says. The second Greek word that is used in the Bible is phileo, and it literally translates friendship. Friendship, and this is the love between friends. It's the city of Philadelphia was named after this word. It's the city of brotherly love, right? Right? The best team in the NFL comes from that city, by the way. I'm sticking with them. I don't care, you guys. But it includes things like loyalty and devotion to our communities. Like, I love Bakersfield, or I love Wasco, Delano, wherever you're from. I love my city. I love my community, my family, my friends. The way you feel about things that you're committed to, that is phileo. It's used a bunch of different times in Scripture. I'll give you one of them in Matthew chapter 10. We just get that one word, the one English word, love, but the Bible gives us so many. And Jesus says here in Matthew 10, he says, anyone who phileos or is more devoted to or loyal to his father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Which makes sense. It makes a lot of sense when you know the understanding of the word he's saying. Because some people say, well, that's a contradiction. Because Jesus is telling us to love our parents and to love, you know, everybody. And here he's saying, don't love them as much as you love me. What is he saying? Well, it's a different kind of love he's talking about. This is phileo. In other words, what he's saying is don't be devoted to or loyal to something or someone more than you are to me. That's what God's saying. Like your phileo for them and the things of this world cannot be more than your devotion and loyalty to me. Here's the third Greek word I want to point out to you. It's not found in Scripture, but it is very common. It's a common love that we understand. And that is the Greek word eros. Eros, and it means physical attraction. And eros kind of gets a bad rap. It's where we get the word erotic, right? Erotic, but we think it's purely centered around sexuality, and it's not. It literally means, you know, anything that the body craves. Anything. So eros would fit into the whole I love pizza. That's an eros. I love chocolate. I love ice cream. It goes anywhere from food to physical intimacy. That's where eros kind of fits in. And the reason why I point these three words out to you is because I kind of think that most of us understand love on these three levels. Like, we're comfortable with these three levels. We even operate in love on these three levels. But if you only understood love on these levels that we've discussed so far, you will never fully comprehend the love that God has for you. And God wants to work through you. You'll know the greatest power of what love is really about. Because you see, my friends, love is more than just natural affection that you have for people that you have an affinity with, or you have inherently, you know, close to, like your family, or it's more than the love you have to something you're devoted to, like your city or your church or your friends or your. It's more, way more than just something your body craves and that you desire inwardly. There's a fourth word that's used that I think few people really understand. I think a lot of us have heard this word if you've been around church a while, but I would even wager to say that a lot of us are farther from this than where we would be ready to admit. Because when you get down to it, what we're going to talk about today, this is a radical love. This is a love, it's hard. This is a hard, tough love. It's the deepest, greatest, purest love of all. The word agape in Scripture is used most of any other word of love. And it literally means unconditional love. Unconditional. You know what that means? It's selfless. It's a love that literally says, I'm not going to take my opinions, my beliefs, my feelings into this. This is a love that's purely for you. It's not about me. This is a love that is about you. It's an intentional love that does something for someone else regardless of the cost or the consequence to oneself. It's an unconditional, sacrificial love. It's the most vulnerable loves. To love is to be vulnerable, isn't it? You're putting yourself out there. It's the moment you love someone, you subject yourself to it and possibly to a broken heart. And so what a lot of us have done because of either past experience or maybe the force of your will, whatever it be, we've kind of tried to protect our love. We wrap it up in hobbies and little luxuries and hide it away from things that can potentially hurt it. We lock it up in a safe or in a casket or a coffin of our selfishness. And I'm telling you, you're not protecting your heart. Please hear this. Listen, you're not protecting your heart. You're changing it. You're changing your love. You're changing your heart. What is growing and festering in the darkness of your selfishness, of your covering of your heart, is changing. It's changing it to something it wasn't supposed to be. Unbreakable, impenetrable, and irredeemable. To love is to be vulnerable. Here's an example of that word used here in John 15 and 13. Jesus says, "Greater agape has no one than this, that he laid down his life for his friends." Because the greatest love of all simply says, I'm not taking my own feelings into consideration here. This love is for you. No matter the cost for me, I am fully committed. It's all for you. Agape, the greatest love of all. You say, Pastor, I don't know. Jesus kind of took this way out of my reach. He raised the bar way too high here. I don't think I can do that. And if you say that today, you're right. He raised the bar very, very high. Jesus was radical. He said radical things. He did radical things. He said radical things like that next verse in your handout, Matthew 5. He said, "But I tell you, love your enemy." Like, unconditionally love your enemy, the one who's trying to hurt you and manipulate you. Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. And I want you to do this so that you may be, please listen to this, I want you to do that so that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. And you can read that the way you want, but the way I see that verse saying is, this is how you'll know. This is how you'll know if you're a son. You can't even get to me, God is saying, if you're not willing to go to this place and accept this agape love and work it out in your relationships with other people. This is how you'll know if you're a son of the Father, if you're a daughter of the King. Once again, Jesus raises the bar when he says in John 13, "A new commandment I give to you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another." He raised the bar to the highest level because the love that Jesus showed us was a sacrificial love. He took it to the cross. He died for us. He's saying, I want you to love people that way, the way that I did it. And I'm looking out in the audience right now and people are going, you got to be kidding me. Like, that's impossible. How can I do that? That's the question. The question is, of the day is, how in the world can I live up to this agape standard of love? Here's the answer. There's a secret to it. Here's the secret in 1 John chapter 4, verse 19. It says, we can agape because God first gave us agape. You see, I'm ordinary. I cannot do this type of extraordinary love, this unconditional. It is not within my capacity to do this. But when I experience, when God gives me His agape love, I now have the power. It's like a river flowing through my heart. It cannot contain. I can't hide it. I can't stuff it. I can't protect it. It bursts out into every relationship of my life because God agape'd me. I gotta agape people. It can't stay in. So the secret, write this down, the secret of love is being loved by God. That's the secret of all this is you can't do this. You cannot love this way. This love is impossible unless you receive it from God. We love, we agape only because He gave us agape first. Now, I looked throughout the scriptures and I found six words, six kind of commandments of love that you cannot get away from this. You can't. These are not optional things that we are supposed to do, or God holds us to this standard of love. There are six things that if we do, we can have this kind of agape love flowing from our life into our relationships. Like if we do these six things, this is possible. You can have this agape love in your relationships. Let me give them to you. I got six of them today. Number one, write these down. Number one is to, and by the way, this first one is really, it's seemingly the easiest. You might think it's the easiest, but this is the most important one. You cannot do the rest of the five unless we get this right, unless we do this one here. So concentrate closely on this first one, and that is number one, to love God fully. To love God fully. If you want to be this person of agape love, you need to love God fully. And the key word here is fully, because I'm convinced that in church buildings all over this city, all over the state, country, all over the world this morning, people are coming into a church, and I am convinced that they love God. That many of them love God. They just don't love God fully. See, I believed in God. I was one of those people. I was one of those people that went to church but didn't love God fully. I mean, I believed in God, but I have one foot in the world and one foot in the church, and I didn't want to do it fully God's way, completely God's way, because I couldn't see that working at all anyway. I can't do that anyway. So I just rode that fence of religion, and I'm telling you, please listen, this thing called Christianity, following Jesus, it does not work unless you love God fully. Like, it does not work. This is not going to work with you straddling that fence. The only way, you're going to continue to be frustrated with Christianity. You're going to be frustrated with your relationships. As long as you got one foot in and one foot out, you're going to be frustrated with yourself. You're going to be up and down, in and out. I'm telling you, it does not work until you give God your whole heart, until you experience His whole love. You can't do this. And you'll just be frustrated. It doesn't work unless you love Him fully. Fully. With everything you have. Because the Bible is clear that if you're having trouble with people, and I bet most of us in the room are, would everyone agree with me? Like, you're having some trouble with some people? Anyone? You guys are lying up in here. Every one of you probably have some trouble somewhere. There you go. Because people are difficult, aren't they? People can be hard and mean, and you can be hard and mean as well. Someone else, some other church, someone's going, thinking of you, going, yeah, Pastor, that's a difficult one. Yeah. They're thinking of you. People are difficult. They're challenging sometimes, and it makes it hard to love them. They're hard to get along with. But if you've got relationship issues with someone, the issue might not be with that person. It literally might be a reflection of your relationship with God. You say, Jason, how can you say that? You don't know me. You don't know me. You can't judge me. How are you judging me? You can't say that. Just let's look at what the scripture says. Look at 1 John chapter 4 when it says, dear friends, let us love one another. Let's agape one another. For love, the key thing here, look, love comes from God. You can't agape. You don't have that within you. I can't agape nobody. I don't have that in me. It comes from God. The only way that I can is if I got it from Him. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Well, that makes sense now, because if the agape is there, He must have got it from the only person who can. He was born of God. He knows God. He's got agape. But whoever does not love, let me say it this way, if you're having relationship issues with people, whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. What's the Bible saying there? The Bible is clearly saying to us that if you have issues with people, it might be because you never fully have experienced the love of God for yourself. Because once you really do, once you experience, honestly, the next five are simple. The next five things that I'm going to give you, it comes out of the overflow of the agape you've experienced from God. See, one thing I really wouldn't want you to hear at the end of this message, I really don't want you to leave here feeling condemned. I don't want you to leave here going, man, that's just too much. I can't do that. There's no way I can attain that kind of love, you raised the bar way past me, Pastor. I can't do it. And you leave here frustrated. Look, that's Christianity is, and I think far too many people think that following Jesus is a hard thing to do. Like it's difficult. If you leave here today and you try to work on this list, you will fail because it is hard. But Christianity was never intended to be done that way. Christianity, following Jesus, is literally coming to God going, God, help me. I can't do it. I can't do it, God. I need your help. And you experience His love personally for yourself to the degree that you become His love. You experience it so much that you become it and you are literally transformed by it. And you can't get, if you can't get number one, the next five just won't, it won't work. But here they are anyway, you guys. Number two, the Bible calls us to this standard, to accept others unconditionally. To accept others unconditionally. If you're anything like me, I was trained to treat people the way they treat me. I was trained, if they're nice to me, I'm nice to them. If they're rude to me, they don't deserve my respect. I'm going to be rude to them. They're mean to me, I'm going to be mean. If they get me, I'm going to get them back. That's the way I was raised. It's like you match the level of relationship or love that people give you. That's not what the Bible calls us to. The Bible calls us to an unconditional love. Romans 15 and 7 says, accept one another then. And again, look at the standard, you guys. Accept one another then just as Christ accepted you in order to bring praise to God. Why is that so important, you guys? Because every one of us needed acceptance. Every one of us needed acceptance. Every one of us needed Jesus to step in and say, okay, you're not deserving and you're not worthy, but I like you anyway. You're not even likable, but I like you anyway, and I love you, and I'm going to love you anyway, even though you're unlovable. Every one of us needed that level of acceptance from God, and that doesn't mean we approve what people do, by the way, when you accept them. Just because you accept someone doesn't mean you approve of them or approve of their choices or you approve of their lifestyle. That's another just crazy, unrealistic expectation that culture is trying to put on you today, that if you accept me, then you have to affirm everything about me. And if you don't affirm everything about me, then you're not really accepting me. That's not true. That is not true, you guys. Listen, this church, we accept everybody in this church from every walk of life, from every belief, every sin. We're all sinners saved by grace. No matter what you're doing, no matter who you are, you're going to be accepted here. We're going to love you here. We're going to hug you here. We're just going to do life with you right here. We're going to accept you unconditionally, but I don't have to affirm everything you're doing. Okay, there's a difference. I'm going to love you, and I'm going to accept you because God loves you. And God has a plan for your life, but it doesn't mean just because I embrace you and accept you that we affirm everything about that person's lifestyle. And this is so important. It's one of the hallmarks of this church, you guys, that we accept everybody. It doesn't mean we affirm, but we love them. We embrace them. We accept them. Accept unconditionally. Why? Because that's how He treated me. Because God accepted me when I was unacceptable. When I was at my worst, accept others unconditionally. Here's the third one, and that is to commit yourself personally. Commit yourself personally, and the key word here is personally, because I'm convinced that we will commit ourselves to the degree that we think other people are going to commit themselves to us. So I'm only gonna give so much because you're only gonna give so much. I mean, if you're only gonna give 10, I'm only gonna give 10. I'm not gonna give more to this relationship than you're giving this. Why should I give more than you're giving me? I'm only gonna commit myself to the level that. And so we act this way in all of our relationships. Like, so I'm not gonna work 100% for this job. Ain't nobody here working 100%. Why am I the only one carrying this whole weight? Why do I give 100% when everyone else is giving 40, 50 and skating around? Skipping on their job. God says, commit yourself personally, not depending on what other people are doing or not doing. And I did a whole message on this. It was part one, actually, in the series. If you missed that, man, I want you to go hear that. It was called Extraordinary Commitment. And we just talked about this level of commitment that we are to bring into relationships that's not dependent on whether someone else is committed or someone else's choices. I mean, the greatest commitment, I think, is when someone dogs you, someone hurts you, or someone even walks out on you and you say, I'll be here when you get back. No, I'm committed. Because what you're doing has nothing to do with the decision I made. I'm committed to you. That's the greatest level of commitment. It's an extraordinary commit yourself personally. Because the Bible says in Romans 12, 10, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. And I know what you're thinking, Jason, this is tough. I know it's tough, you guys, I do. And as I was even writing this stuff and studying, I was getting beat up by it. Because there's some things on here that God is working on me. I'm writing it down going, okay, God, I need your help. And I ain't telling you which ones they are, just you don't get to know, okay? Me and God, no, but these are tough. These are the standard of agape that God has put in our life, that we just need to draw the line and we say, no, I'm not going to do ordinary. I'm not going to follow the behaviors and the customs of the world, of the way the world says what love is. No, I'm gonna do extraordinary love. I'm going to experience your love, God, that gives me the capacity to love people the way you want me to love people. Here's number four. Encourage others, keyword, continually. Encourage others continually. Continually meaning you don't get to pick and choose. It's raining. It's sun is shining. It's a good day. It's a bad day. You want to have this agape type of love in your life, you need to commit to encouraging the people around you continually. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 11 says, therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as, in fact, you're doing. What a great reputation. I want you to know, I want this to be my reputation, that people say, man, just after meeting with me or having coffee with me or spend a little bit of time with me, that they would leave and feel better about themselves. That's what I want. I want a reputation of an encourager, not where people get around me and they feel a little dirty because, man, I'm talking about people, or they feel like a little, they think differently about people because of my perspective of them, or different from, and just criticism or negativity, or I want the reputation that when people get around me, man, they know they're going to get a high five, pat in the back, they're going to feel better about themselves, that I'm going to be an uplifter and encourage people, and I'm not going to be a downer. I'm going to be an addition to their life, not a subtraction to their life. Be an encourager. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and 7 talks about when it's difficult to be an encourager, when it's hard, when it's not going well, or doesn't, when everything is kind of not looking right, to still be the encourager. If you love someone, you will always believe in him and always expect the best of him. You want something that'll help your marriage or your relationships, write down this extra little phrase, this extra note, write this down. Treat people the way you want them to become, not the way they are. You treat people the way you want them to become, not the way they are. You encourage life in them. You speak life into them, and people will rise to the level of your expectation and the level of your communication. This is so important. You parents, you don't just be the primary disciplinarian of your kids and just disciplining and spanking and putting them in line and putting them in the order. Look, yes, as the parent, you are supposed to be the primary disciplinarian in that relationship. But if your primary function in the relationship is known as disciplinarian, you are crushing the dreams and the potential of your children. Your primary function as a parent is to speak life into and help your children reach their God-given potential in life. It's to encourage their growth, not to diminish their growth. Man, I learned this even in your marriages. Some of you speaking down into, man, if you want that guy to finally shape up and act right, start speaking to him like the man you want him to be then, and not like the man you think he is or like he's acting. Stop talking down to him and calling him names and speak some life over that man, and he'll rise to the level of your expectation and the level of your communication. I learned this like many years ago in parenting when, man, I was doing it wrong. I was correcting my kids or trying to get them to behave and do the right thing. And, man, and God convicted me. I learned that I can get so much more out of my kids and from my kids by patting them on the back than by spanking them on the butt. I mean, treat people the way that you want them to become, not that the way that they are. Encourage others continually. Here's the fifth thing that extraordinary love does. The fifth thing it does is it serves people cheerfully. Serve people cheerfully. You know, every one of you in this room, you have gifts. You have talents. You have abilities. You have resources. Every one of you. And I'm not trying to like put anyone in like a guilt trip or put any pressure on anyone. Please don't hear it that way. But every one of you have abilities. You have things. You have resources. You have talents. Every one of you do. God gave you those things. But can I say something to you? And I'm not trying to be rude. It's not for you. God didn't give you He never gave you any of those things, abilities, talents, gifts, ideas, resources, time, energy, health, finances. That's not for you. He gave you those gifts and abilities for one purpose. And it was that you would, in your lifetime, you'd have an opportunity to use that to influence others, to bless other people. That's why He gave it to you, to bless others. The Bible says in 1 Peter 4:10, each one of you should use whatever gift, like you've been given it, you've got a lot of great things God has blessed you with, each one should use whatever gift God has given him that he has received to serve others. And if you're anything like me, I prayed, Lord, make me a servant. Oh, I want to serve you, God. Make me into a faithful, good servant. I want to serve you, God. And here's the question. It was an ouch moment for me. How do you know that you have a servant's heart? How do you know? The answer is simple. How do you react when people treat you like one? Yeah, ouch, right? That was an ouch moment for me. I mean, how do you react when people boss you around? How do you react when people tell you what to do? When in fact, those are the prayers we pray. Lord, I want to be a servant. I want to serve you, God. All right, God says, here we go. Here we go. Let me put you... And then we get all upset. See, the Bible says, if you really want to know what love is, you need to understand that your life is not your own. Your life is not yours. The things you have are not for you, that you live your life to the benefit of other people around you, because love is intentionally doing something for someone else and caring for them in the name of Jesus without thought or consideration of oneself. Without thinking of what we're going to get in return, it serves people cheerfully. And if you thought those were hard, those five were hard, let me just warn you, this last one is tough. This is the hardest, I think, and it's impossible to do, again, if you don't do number one, and that is to forgive others freely. Forgive others. Extraordinary love. Agape love. Forgives others freely. Just let it go. And the truth is, there are many of us in this room that have issues right now with other people. And you need to see what Colossians chapter 3 says. Look at it with me up here on the screen. Colossians 3:13. It says, bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. And then here's the bar. Here's the standard. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. Now I want you to look up here for just a moment. Please hear me out on this, because every time I preach on this, I get emails, I get messages, I get people, they say, well, Pastor Jason, you don't know what I've been through. You don't know. It's every time I talk about this, you don't know what, man, this is what happened. Look, I'm not saying forgiveness is not minimizing the seriousness of the offense. I'm not saying it wasn't serious. And I'm not saying it wasn't wrong. It was wrong. I'm not saying it wasn't those things. It was hurtful, it was spiteful, maybe it was vindictive, whatever it was. I'm not saying it wasn't those things. It's not even letting them off the hook when you forgive people. You're not letting them off the hook. It simply says, when you forgive others freely, it simply says two things. Number one, it says, I'm not going to be the one to hold it against you. I'm not going to hold this any longer in my heart against you. Yes, it will be held against you. There's one day it'll be brought into account before the judge, and I'm not the judge. So I'm not going to keep this in my heart. That's what forgiveness says. I'm not going to hold it against you. You see, it'll be brought into account either in the blood of Christ or at the judgment seat of Christ. It's going to be brought into account, and it's not up to me. So I'm releasing that to God. That's what forgiveness says. And second thing it says, the reason I do it isn't because I feel like doing it. But the reason I forgive freely is because that I cannot allow the freedom flow from heaven to me to stop. I can't stop the flow of freedom, of forgiveness. The Bible says that just as we forgive others is going to be the forgiveness that God will use to forgive us. And I don't know about you, but I need forgiveness every day. I need forgiveness all the time. And if I ever withhold in my heart and I stop forgiving others, the Bible says that that flow of forgiveness will be bottlenecked in my life. I'll prevent it. Look, and this is, I know it's hard, and I'm not saying from here, this is not what I'm saying. I'm not saying, hey, here's a list of things, you got to go do it. Now go do those things, and I know you're not doing it bad, Christian. Go do those things. That's not what I'm saying. That's not what I am saying is, the reason why we're not doing these things in our life, it's an indicator. It's showing that we haven't done the first thing. It's showing the reason why I'm not serving others cheerfully, the reason why I'm not forgiving others freely, the reason why that this is not happening in my life isn't because I'm not trying hard enough. It's because I've forgotten the love that God has for me. There's a block. There's something. There's a bottleneck somewhere, and I'm telling you that's the bottleneck. In order to accomplish this stuff, I'm not telling you go out of here and try harder. Just go love people and go sacrifice yourself and give your life away. No, you're gonna fail. What I am saying we need to do is we need to cry out to God again. Look, if any of these are becoming difficult for you, then we need to remember again the love of God. We need to again cry out and say, God, I need your love. I need to experience it again in my life, again to the point where it brings me to tears that I'm broken again of my sin, of my shame, of the debt that was paid for me. When I think about the extent of your immeasurable, unconditional love that you paid, the price upon your body was broken for me. Let it draw you again. Drink in the agape love of God, and it'll flow again into your relationships. It'll be natural. It will not be, you won't be able to prevent that love. I'm not telling you to try harder. I'm telling you to experience God again. That's what I'm saying. Experience God again. It'll change your relationships. This extraordinary love, I'm telling you, you'll move from this ordinary, resentful, regretful, bitter, if you just let God love you again. If you take in the agape, unconditional love again, it'll move you from ordinary to extraordinary. Come on, let's bow our heads right there.